Good evening. Who in this room is tracking or measuring themselves with some kind of a wearable or a mobile app? Almost everybody, yeah? You all have a smartphone, I suppose, or a smartwatch? Yes? Okay. Know that these smartphones and smartwatches also tracking passively certain parameters, such as steps and heart rates, as also the prospect of profiling. Think about target marketing, target advertising, and personalized ads. In this talk, I would like to present to you a digital twin in healthcare, and we're focusing on the citizens and patients, not specifically on medical professionals. I will give you an example. In smart city development and design, we install smart traffic lights for the pedestrians, the bikers, and the cars. Pedestrians have the priority. And what I observe in my environment is that the bikers taking the spots of the pedestrians in order to have a faster green light. They actually cheat, right? So in a digital twin, we could simulate these situations and forecast what's going to happen, and also, if needed, anticipate on it. Yes. So in digital twins in healthcare, we represent humans. This can be on an organ level or on systems like blood flow or digesting. Digital twins in healthcare, the notion arises because we have digitized health. In our hospitals today, the data is digitized. With our general practitioners, the data is digitized. In our environment through Internet of Things, and you showed all that we humans also gather a lot of data about lifestyle components. And within these digital twins, we can simulate and forecast. What do you think? Is this a good idea? Not so sure, yeah? Let's look at some issues. Data privacy. Who is working on the data and who is analyzing the data? Whose goals are prioritized? Who is benefiting and who is at risk and disadvantaged? All these issues we really need to tackle in digital twins in healthcare and in preventive healthcare in general. In order to create trust in these technologies. So look at some problem statements. First, we really need to avoid bias by design. Bias by design means that today, in our data, in historical data, minorities are not included. Minorities such as age, race, gender, sexual orientation, disabilities, or literacy. So these systems really ask for multidisciplinary teams from in the beginning of the design and the development. So not at the end or in between, in the full design cycle and development. I will give you an example. Facial recognition today, these systems often don't recognize people of other color. They just don't exist, right? A second problem is we really need to ensure inclusive policy design. And certainly in a data-driven world where new policies can be derived from this data. If the minorities are not in there, they're not existing and they're not accounted for. I will give you another example. In 2015, Amazon wanted to recruit new employees, and their computer models were trained and vetted with applications from historical data over a period of 10 years' time. Of course, this data reflected the male dominance in the technology industry. I think we all know that, right? The third problem is the technical challenges. All the data of these wearable apps and mobile apps that we are using are in silos. There is no context at all. We often see that in the feedback loops. I don't know how you experience it, but I'm really, it annoys me. So there's no context at all. They're not connected. In hospitals, they choose, have proprietary software, and they choose their own software. There are no industry standards. So this is really a problem. Trust and robustness of these systems is also a major requirement. Think about the breaches that are there, the hacks, and the data brokers. But maybe even more and a bigger challenge is the values and the norms in these systems. As we see today, more and more increasingly difference between the values and the norms in a US continent and in a European continent. Look at the abortion law. Last year, the US decided in 26 states, this is not on a federal level, it's on state by state, 26 states decided to justify an abortion that has to be limited to 6 weeks. While we in Europe are just extending this, just recently, this year, from 12 to 14 weeks to justify an abortion. And as you know, or might not know, there are menstruation cycle apps where we can track our menstruations, yes. And we already see a decline in the usage of these apps with women because they're afraid to be tracked and traced and to be punished in cases of abortion. And the companies who develop these apps are looking at different data protection to secure the trust of these apps. Also in Europe, by the way, so this is also here ongoing. All our Western data, 92% is stored in the US. These are figures from 2018, so it might change a little bit, but not much, I think. So that's also something to think about. Where is the data stored? So geographically, there are things happening as well. In Eastern Europe, in Hungary, they decided last year to censor LGBT content. Indeed, in an authoritarian regime, a digitized world is a wet dream for every dictator, right? I think we can all agree on that. So we also might wonder if the US has such a dominance in data, do we as a European continent still have digital sovereignty? And are we going in the future, are we going to build digital walls or digital borders, especially in a healthcare environment, right? Because the US regulation, as I just told you, and abortion and so on, US regulation and legislation is different. I just want to close with you one statement here. One wonders within a digital twin in healthcare if we still have the freedom and the room to be just a human with all our complexities, characteristics, and so on, to have a carefree life. I would like to close with this statement. Thank you. Thank you.